Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome on this session on monitoring and visualization methods. My name is Evelyn Volke from Ghent University. It's my pleasure to be your chairperson for this session. We have four speakers. The first of them is Hanneke Schuurmans. Hanneke has 11 years of experience as a hydrologist. She says herself that connecting new scientific innovations with daily practice forms her biggest motivation. Motivation is what we all need, right? And her expertise is mainly in the field of regional hydrology, agrohydrology, and hydrometeorology, and the use of remote sensing techniques in hydrology. She has gained her PhD at Utrecht University in physical geography in 2008, and she now works for DHV as an advisor and project leader hydrology. At the moment, she's working for several water boards and drinking water companies to implement remote sensing techniques in daily practice. Please, the floor is yours.
Yes, good afternoon. Thank you very much for the introduction. Indeed, I'm Hanneke Schuurmans from Royal Haskoning DHV at the moment, not even DHV anymore. And I'm giving the presentation, but Joanneke van Vossen from Nelen and Schuurmans, she is in the room as well. Yeah, we Dutch people, we like to talk about rainfall, mainly because rainfall occurs here more than we want to. I would like to talk about you about RainApp. But first of all, the connection between hydrology and IT, because that's the goal of this conference. Then something about the rainfall radar, which is a remote sensing technique, some backgrounds, and then about the RainApp, which is a web application, a viewer, to view those data. Well, first of all, rainfall is the driving force for hydrology. You see the hydrological cycle here. And mainly in the Netherlands, where about 800 millimeters a year are falling, it's really the driving force for our hydrological system. What you see in hydrology, what occurs the last years, is that there are more and more data coming available. A lot of remote sensing techniques are developing. And besides that, we have hydrological models, and they become faster as well. So what you see here, for example, on the above are the LiDAR data. So we can make elevation models much more in higher detail. So what we had a few years ago, and some are still using, are those grid cells, which have a certain size. But we can go more in detail at the moment. And this is one of the examples of a Dutch innovation of the 3DE, which calculates even 1,000 times faster than the SOBEC models. So I think that water managers, they are becoming more and more also information managers. All those data, how do you know what kind of data you need? And often water managers have the situation, what I try to explain here, is that they have access to some of these data, but there are data that they could use to improve their water management, but they don't know about it or they cannot access it. So I think there's suboptimal water management. And nowadays, what becomes more and more, you heard a lot of talks about this, I think, is that you have a central information system which connects all those data informations and make from data information. So people at water boards, for example, they can have their own dashboard. Well, what are the applications of rainfall radar, or rainfall in general? First of all, is that especially municipalities, they want to know how often certain events occur, yeah? So the return period. On the other hand, water boards are interested in early warning system about the heights of the water levels. And down there, that's hydrological models, which are used for drinking water companies, for example. And those need spatial information about rainfall as well. Well, this is a principle of rainfall radar. A radar doesn't measure rainfall directly. It's an indirect measurement, so it's a remote sensing technique. And you see here what the radar does. It sends out electromagnetic waves, and these are bounced back by rainfall, but also by other things, like, for example, birds. And you have to filter that out. And from these signals, you can determine the rainfall intensity. And radar, by the way, stands for radar detection and ranging. It's a technique that was developed in the 70s, and it's used more and more by water boards these days. What you saw there was a 2D image of a radar, but the radar turns around at different elevations. So that's the end product you get from the radar is the highest, what you see there, those different cones. And then you have to go from 3D data to a 2D data. And that's quite complicated, and that's only one rainfall radar. In the Netherlands, the KNMI, that's the Dutch weather authority, they operate two radars in the Netherlands. One there in Den Helder, and one there in the Bilt. But in Germany, close to the border, there's Emden, Essen, and Oheilebach, and you can use those data as well for the Netherlands. So what we are doing at the moment is combining these radar images, and every 5 minutes we get a new composite of rainfall. And it has a spatial resolution of 1 by 1 kilometer. And we are testing several methods, because what I said, from going from 3D to 2D and combining these radars, there are several methods. And we are testing a few of them. And we do that together with specialists from the KNMI and from Dutch universities, from Universiteit Utrecht and Wageningen University. We discuss about the methods, what we should we do, and then we are implementing them, and we are choosing the best methods out of three. So this is one of the examples of three methods to combine five different radar stations. This is one method, this and this, and this is one day, and this is another day. And we now chose for the last method. Then you have rainfall data purely from radar images, but you are measuring rainfall often at the ground as well, rain gauges. So as soon as a rain gauge is available, we are calibrating the image from the radar. And we do that with KNMI data. Those are the gray points, DWD from the Deutsche Wetterdienst. Those are the blue points, and from the partners that are joining in this research. And they are the yellow ones. And each rain gauge gets a quality stamp. So about this project we are doing, so we are combining, I'm pointing at the back, but okay. We are combining the war images from the KNMI and from Germany and Belgium also, as soon as it comes operational available. We are making composites and make a calibration together with rain gauges as soon as they are available. And we put them on the FTP site, and we make a connection to different applications like Fuse, Whiskey, Hydronet, a basic web viewer for those who don't have a web viewer, and RainApp. But those are viewers, and this is about data, getting the best data. So the RainApp is, well, an app. Is it an app of Apple or... No, it's an app within the Lizard system. You can find more information on www.lizard.net. But the idea behind those apps is that they make connection with several databases like Fuse, Geodin, White. And within Lizard, you can have different kind of applications like the Rain app. I will tell you something about that. So this is a web viewer of the Rain app. You see one of the radar images. And our focus point, why we developed the Rain app, is for the end users. And if this happens, the local authority is not happy, you can imagine. This woman, she looks quite happy still. But and the water authorities want to know how often can these situations occur. So what we do in the web viewer is that we make an aerial, spatial aerial combination of those 1 by 1 kilometer data, and we calculate on the fly on the web the return period. And the return period depends also on the time interval and the area in which it occurs. And this is, it looks easy, but it is results from a PhD of 4 year research. So it looks easy, but behind are some really technical details. But what's so unique about the project and about the Rain app is that it fully is developed in open source, in GPL. So also this research project we do together with universities and research companies, Dataris, and also the KNMI. But it's completely open. So people who say, no, you're not doing it okay, all right, we think we could do it better, they are happy to join, but they also, if they change something, they have to give it back to the original developers. So I think this is really an example of what is in line, the development. This is in line with the free and open data policy that is in the Netherlands. And if there are any questions, please.
Thank you for your presentations. Any questions from the audience?
Jeroen Langeveld, Delft University. Could you please explain a little bit more about how you calibrate a radar? Is it on a 24-hour basis, 5-minute basis, something in between?
No, we... No is not the answer. Yeah, we... They asked us to give calibrated images of 5 minutes. So that's what we are also developing. But the problem is that there are few rain gauges that give information about 5 minute rainfall. So from the Deutsche Wetterdienst we have some information. They measure each minute how much rainfall there is, but they cannot deliver it at the moment real time. So that's 1 hourly back. So we are implementing it, and we are making a software for it to make calibration each 5 minutes. But I think it's not possible because the rain gauges are limiting. But as soon as there are rain gauges available, they are. So there's a 5 minute calibration. After 1 hour, it's done again, and after 24 hours. And the method we are using, we are still in a testing phase. We are doing two things, a combination of a correction factor and the inverse distance weighting, as well as a greeting.
Any further questions?
Then was it so clear or was it so unclear?
Then maybe I will continue with the questions. Now, there are different characteristics of rainfall. You can measure the amount, the duration, the intensity. What do you mainly want to predict with your system?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because what you measure is the rainfall intensity. But indeed, there are several methods to combine, and you have to make choices. And indeed, every method has its own pros and cons. And we ask the end users, so the water boards, what is your main interest? And what we hear back is often that they want to know the intensity and also the high intensity. So what at the moment the KNMI is delivering, they say, yeah, we want nice pictures, for example, but we filter out the high intensities.
And is this something you can measure with the radar as well?
Yes. Yeah. You can measure the intensity. Indeed. Yeah.
Maybe some question from the audience. I think we have time for a couple of more questions. Yes.
Tim Corbin. I do a lot of work in the Netherlands, but also I go across borders. I like what you're doing here. Have you got any, like you're incorporating the German stuff, is there going to be, are you going to set up some sort of network for all of Europe? Because I mean, a Europe-wide body would be really interesting.
For yeah, no, it's interesting indeed. At the moment, the KNMI is developing for the whole European continent in it's called OPERA. You can find it on the internet as well, but it has another planning. It's a long term, because in the Netherlands we have the open, free and open data policy, and the Germans have kind of the same thing, that you can, if you use it for waterboards, you get discount on the data. But for example, the Belgians are you have to pay the full price, so that's also something that is limiting. You have to really cooperate together. But hopefully, And this is the reason why we are doing this, and the KNMI is not doing this, is because they have a law, the KNMI law, and they are not allowed to develop products like this for the market. They have to give it to a market company. But they like it that we do it in open source, and they can join.
Thank you. That was also something that I was wondering on, why the KNMI did not develop the tool itself. Please.
Okay, well, my name is Joanneke van Vossen, the other one.
The co-presenter.
So maybe it's good to point out as well that the current way the system has been set up, that is completely generic. So as soon as more radar or data are available, we can introduce them in very easily. So it's also good to know, I think.
And for the people, in the meantime, for the people who are who can read Dutch or are interested in reading Dutch, there are folders about this project, but because it's developed for the Dutch waterboards, it's in Dutch at the moment. Yeah.
And if not, Google Translate can also be very useful from time to time.
Yeah, Rashid from Morocco. Well, you are talking about calibration, but we want to know about the accuracy of radar data that you get. Thanks.
Yes, that's a good point. Accuracy is, of course, our main interest. It depends on the kind of weather system, how good you are able to get the right rainfall intensities with rainfall radar. What I said, that you measure electromagnetic waves. It's called SET, and you have to make a SET R translation, and this is done at the moment for showers that are widespread. So the really in summer we have very local rainfall events, and those are measured less accurate by the rainfall radar. But we try to get it better with more rain gauges. That's the way how you can get more accurate results. But then you are, what I said, you have to have rain gauges which measure real time. Is that a bit of an answer? Yeah, we make statistics. So what comes out of this project, we also give the statistics. How accurate are you? And of course, there are quite a lot of things we cannot address at the moment, because you get ground clutter or clutter from birds. And that's really something that should be developed further.
Thank you very much for this interesting contribution.